Welcome back, everybody, to G2 Class Legends. I am Sottl, joined here, as always, by my good friend Lothar, and we have just seen an excellent series between Zetalot and Tice. Zetalot just showing an absolute priest masterclass, which is one of the big boons of this tournament format, I think. You get to see these real class specialists like Zetalot just putting in work with that one class that they know inside out, in this case, priest, but that is in the past. We'll hope to see some more of Zetalot in the future, which we will, as he's now through to semi-finals. But coming up next, Lothar, we have Crane versus Ekop.
Yes, Crane versus Ekop. It's a Cloud9 versus London conspiracy match. And this is the second time we'll see Crane play in a broadcasted tournament. Ekop is, of course, I don't want to say something, but it doesn't make any sense in English. I mean, he's just a veteran of the scene, so he's used to played in the broadcast tournaments, but he didn't have a strong showing for a long time, right? Mm-hmm. So I'm sure he will try his best in this tournament, but it's a matchup between Warlock and a Warrior. So there's only Reno Jackson and Zoo, right, in Ekop's lineup, where we did see on the patron from Crane yesterday, so Ekop doesn't have the full information what he will be facing.
Yeah, I mean, you would suspect that the other deck is a Control Warrior from Crane, but much like Zetalot, Crane is very well known amongst the pro circuit as a deck specialist. He's famous for his Grim Patron Warrior play. So I guess there's an outside chance that he just has two different teched out versions of Grim Patron Warrior. Mm-hmm. But yeah, he is very much a patron expert. He's a player that a lot of players, you know, your G2 teammates included, have turned to in the past for a little bit of a patron practice, a little bit of patron tutoring. I know Life Coach and RDU for sure have both practiced patron with him a lot. And we saw that exhibition from him yesterday with the Patron Warrior.
There was one slip up though when he missed a Dr. Boom for 7 mana.
Yeah.
that was quite a funny, but he still won that game, if I remember correctly.
Yeah. It looks like we're going to have the Reno Lock here. Looks like Reno Lock. We have the Chow and the Big Game Hunter showing up in Ekop's hand, and it's going to go straight into the Patron Warrior again from Crane. So Crane keeping faith with his Patron Warrior here and cues it into the Reno Lock first game.
Well, it makes sense, right? Because the Reno Jackson Warlock has less access to mass removal. He only has one Shadow Flame, one Hellfire. Demon Rev doesn't give a damn, right? I mean, the Warrior doesn't give a damn about Demon Rev in most situations. And the Twisting Nether is there. But Twisting Nether in most situations will be too slow.
Yes. Yeah, it comes way too late in the game. There's a couple of opportunities that you have to win this matchup as the Patron Warrior. The first, as you say, is just going all in on Patron Generation as early as possible and hoping they don't have their one copy of Hellfire. And the other, which is definitely available to Crane's build of the deck, or at least the build we saw yesterday, assuming this is the same build. Whoa, that's a Faceless Manipulator.
Okay. Is that the second version then?
It may well be. Looks like.
Well, we saw the very minion concentrated deck from Crane yesterday, right? He was playing Corcoran Elites.
Double Dread Corsair.
Exactly. So it was like build against a druid. Mm-hmm. And in this situation, the Faceless Manipulator might be a tech or will be awesome against control decks in general. Because you can gain tempo by playing a 5 mana copy of a huge opponent's minion and then remove it with an execute, an example.
Yeah, absolutely. And having now seen the Cruel Taskmaster, I'm pretty confident this is a different build here from Crane. We watched 5 games of his Patron Warrior yesterday, and just naturally, Patron Warrior draws a ton of cards because of the Acolytes, the Slams, the Battle Rages. Mm-hmm. You know, maybe we could have not seen the Faceless Manipulator. That's possible, but not seeing a Faceless Manipulator or a Cruel Taskmaster, which we didn't yesterday, would be incredibly unlikely. So pretty convinced this is now just a different build from Crane.
Yeah, kind of, I would say, for Crane, it's not the perfect scenario to be facing the Zombie Chow, because he's not able to damage himself for the possible battle rage in the future, right?
That's so very true.
But he has two weapons. I'm sure that over the course of the game, he will be able to put some damage on himself to get that battle rage going on, which is not yet in his hand still, but...
Wow! Ooh, that's a big card.
That is an awesome pickup by Eco.
We do see the... Okay, now we have the answer.
Yeah, now we have the answer.
We know what it is. The Worgen Patron deck. The Faceless Manipulator that is there to just create an extra copy of the Worgen if he needs to do it that way. So if you aren't familiar with this deck, it's a variation of the old school Worgen OTK deck, but based on the Patron engine now. So you play most of the Grim Patron Warrior cards, but then you're also carrying a Rampage, a Charge, a Raging Worgen, etc. Trying to deal with some different threats that way.
Now this is a very good matchup for Crane, because I still remember the times where the Worgen Warrior was the pick to go, the go-to pick, where he wanted to face a Handlock. It was basically always winning against Handlock, because there were so many ways of clearing the board and just removing the taunters and then finish your opponent off by one swoop, in one huge swing, right? With the Worgen for like 800. And that was basically it. This might be very similar, but the problem is Crane has cards like Grim Patron and other cards that make an investment in a special in a certain playstyle, right? And they are taking the slots for other cards like Brawls, an example.
Yes, for sure. And it was a really interesting sequence of turns there. I think the armor pass opening from Crane had possibly convinced Ecop that he was facing against a Control Warrior. And he actually decided to develop a Twilight Drake instead of oozing down the Deathbite. I think if you were suspecting patrons to come out there, you certainly would have oozed down the Deathbite, just suspicious of the patron in a rage play that you would have had no answer to. So yeah, he chose to just develop the Drake. Crane chose to answer just by making two patrons, which did get answered by the implosion from Ecop, but don't blame Crane there at all just for going for the board presence with the patrons, because he does have basically a full backup in hand with a second Deathbite and a second Grim Patron.
Yep, the problem is there's the Echoing Ooze, and that's something that Crane is not aware of, right? Because it will put the problem for turn 7, where his plan was to play Crew Taskmaster into Patron and develop four patrons, but now he's not able to, because I'm sure as hell that Ecop will destroy the second death spot right now, even though it kills the 1/1s that he has.
Yeah, definitely feels like the play here. He can coin out the Sludge Belcher as well to go for some board presence, or just make a Dark Peddler play if he wants to hold on to his coin. But honestly, destroying the second Deathbite is so much more valuable against Patron in a lot of situations, or at least it feels a lot better to know that you're just now done with Deathbite forever. It's just such a powerful card, such a dangerous card in the deck, that eliminating the second one always feels great. And Crane has a little adjustment in his seat, doesn't feel completely comfortable with the situation anymore. As you said, his plan here was very much Grim Patron, Cruel Taskmaster on this turn to start flooding the board.
And now, well, for Ecop, now it doesn't look that bad, because Crane is stuck with his passive hand, right?
Yes.
The Rampage is basically garbage for the most of the game. Charge, the same issue. Faces Manipulator, the same stuff.
Yep.
Cruel Taskmaster most likely will be used in a combo with the second set of patrons. Wow, this is not looking good. You can't even cycle the slam.
No option to cycle the slam. Cruel Taskmaster will answer the 3-1, but it's just not a particularly good threat on the board right now. Just no real proactive plays here for Crane to make, so he's going to have to try and find some way out of this, or it may just be an armor pass turn here from the Warrior.
He goes for the...
Wow.
Oh my god.
Desperation plays here. Just hoping there's no answer to the Patron, but there are in fact several. He can Owl it. He can just wall it out with the Sludge Belcher. If he wanted to just go extreme overkill, we could even just Twisting Nether this board, but I'm sure he won't be forced to react that hard. The Owl is going to come down, and that is the end of Grim Patrons for this game now. Crane is now going to be all in on that Raging Worgen strategy.
Well, now it means that Ecop had solved the problem of double sets of patrons. And it wasn't really that problematic. He didn't have to use a Hellfire, a Shadow Flame, or even a Twisting Nether.
Yeah, absolutely. Slam is going to come down, draw a card. Battle Rage is a reasonable pickup. He may choose to cycle that right now with the Inner Rage just to get some more options in his hand, which he chooses to do. Inner Rage not going to have any effect on this board, but he is going to be able to pick up two more cards. Emperor is a nice pickup. He has some decent cards in his hand to discount. The Charge, the Rampage, and the Faceless Manipulator will create a lot of damage for when the Raging Worgen comes into hand.
I don't think that... I'm sure as hell that Crane will calculate how does he win the game and if he has even a way of winning this game after using one Inner Rage already, and how much damage can he dish out in the upcoming turns, right? Because if he's not able to kill Ecop straight away in the upcoming turns, I'm sure that he will not show the cards that he has in the deck, like Rampage, like Charge, like Defaceless Manipulator. He doesn't want to show the strategy. So Ecop might be caught off guard next turn because he still thinks it's a patron that just happens to run. Wait, he didn't show the owl still. Okay, never mind. He didn't show anything right now that tells the strategy is that is something different from the usual patron deck.
Yeah, the only vaguely interesting card that he's played is Cruel Taskmaster, which is not always an inclusion in the current mid-range patron, but that's not good enough to like set off any alarm bells to your opponent. So you're completely right. Like, the alternate Worgen strategy of this deck is completely concealed at this point. And again, the Emperor is a little bit suspicious. Might set off some alarm bells in Ecop's head here, but I think Crane definitely feels like he still has enough of a chance in this game to keep being committed. If he draws the Worgen now, he is able to play his whole hand, including the Faceless Manipulator.
Mm-hmm. And so that will be how much damage? It's 4, 8, 10. That's 20 damage.
Okay.
So many possibilities.
20? Am I right? No. It's way more. It's 30, actually.
Is it
40? So... Wait. It's double Worgen with charge, right? And each... what am I counting? Let's start away. Free damage from Worgen, basic. Whirlwind deals upgrades the attack to 4.
Yes.
Then you have Rampage, upgrades to 7. Then we have the Charge, upgrade to 10. So that's 20 damage from just one Worgen. Then Faceless comes down, so it's actually 40 damage.
Holy crap. Alright, that's a lot.
And that's playable next turn.
It's playable next turn if he draws Raging Worgen, yeah. But unfortunately, some Fury Protector is going to put a little bit of a crimp in that plan. I'm sure he will probably choose to taunt up the Dr. Boom here, because no other taunts... Yeah.
So imagine he will be one of lethal. No, wait. He would still have lethal unless the bombs would have killed the... No, he wouldn't. He'd have lethal.
Yeah, he'd have 23, right? Yeah.
23. One of lethal if he would have get the Worgen right now.
Mm-hmm.
So I guess you can armor up and silence the Dr. Boom if you want to win next turn.
If you're going to win next turn, I think you actually silence a Boom Bot. Because you're going to have enough mana. Are you 3, 7, 10? No, you need 10 mana to play the Worgen. Okay.
Exactly. So this is why you have to...
You have to silence the Boom, yeah. The risk, of course, is that you're going to make like the Raging Worgen Whirlwind play while there's two active Boom Bots on the board. So you may just end up losing your Worgens before they're able to do their charge damage. Which is why I was thinking about silencing a Boom Bot, but then you don't have enough mana left over to execute the Dr. Boom after the Whirlwind. So.
All right, now he doesn't have a way of activation.
He's still fine, actually, because he can use the first Worgen.
Oh, you're right,
the
attack. So he has two attacks.
The 2-1, and then the Faceless Manipulator will still be enough damage.
So it's 3 times at the attack.
Yes.
He loses just one attack, so it's still 30 damage.
Yep.
Oh, that's a cool thing to see.
And there's the Kezan Mystic that we saw do so much work from Ecop in the last series against Oskaka's Mage. Obviously not going to have as much of an effect in this matchup, but still reasonable to play out on board here as a 4-3. Obviously he'd love it to be a Pilot Shredder in this situation, but just going to play it out here just to get some additional pressure on the board. He's going to Reno Jackson back to full health, and he's still dead if the Vorgan is drawn.
That would be hilarious. I wonder how many Vorgans are in the deck. Ah, unfortunately, that's not a Vorgan.
It's not a Vorgan. He's back to 40 damage, though. Oh, no, he isn't, because the Whirlwind is costs a mana now, so he can't cast it in the same turn. He does still have 30 damage as soon as the Vorgan is drawn, so he just has to find some way to live here.
But he's dead next, unfortunately, because of the Jaraxxus.
Right. He can theoretically survive by owling the Dragon Egg. Owling the Dragon Egg and then Whirlwinding plus armor up would keep him alive against the Jaraxxus, but I'm 100% certain that's not a play we're going to see here.
Yeah. It's probably just armor up and hope your opponent will not kill you. If he does kill you, then too bad. You are in a bad spot anyway. But if he doesn't kill you and you have another chance of winning the game with another Vorgan draw, then you're okay with that. But I think Crane wouldn't want to show the secret tactic in his hand, right?
Yep. Yeah, it makes a lot of sense. So it'd be interesting here whether... I'm sure Crane has picked this version of Patron as an answer to the potential control deck. I'm sure if he, like, against Zoo, I think he'd much rather be playing, like, the regular Patron. Seems a lot more consistent against Zoo. So knowing that he's queuing back into the control Warlock here, I'm sure he's just going to re-queue this Vorgan OTK variant.
Hmm. Okay, so, no problem, the same. It doesn't mean
there we go.
Yep. It's the same. So what will be the opening hand? You want to get cycles through to, in your opening hand? I guess he plays some Gnomish Inventors, maybe. And maybe that's it. I don't see a lot of slots available when you invest in both Patrons and Organ, right, at the same time.
Right. Acolyte of Pain, I guess, is likely, and then I guess maybe Loot Hoarders are a possibility, depending on the build of the deck. There's an Acolyte, but I guess he's just looking for Deathspite in the opening hand, as always with any type of Patron Warrior, and then things like Acolyte, and as you said, Gnomish Inventor, if he's running them, will be the additional things that he's looking for. There is a Gnomish! Yeah, good call, Lothar.
Hmm. Well, it doesn't look bad, like, this time around. He has an Acolyte of 10-3, 10-4... Gnomish Inventor. It seems like a good way of getting those combo pieces in hand for the future turns.
Yeah, sure does.
Ooh, slam as well. Yeah,
additional cycle. We see the deck's also running Shield Block, which is another cycle tool that we don't see in Patron anymore.
Mm-hmm. I guess might be a good thing to even slam your own Acolyte of Pain next turn if you don't want to commit the Gnomish Inventor, but it's so tempting. I guess a proper way of playing the turn 4, if you would have a shield slam in your hand, would be slam your own Acolyte and armor up, right? But in this case, probably we just Acolyte of Pain into turn 4 Gnomish Inventor.
Mm-hmm.
It all depends what will Ekop do on turn 3, because he can't drop the Imp Gang boss when there's a Acolyte of Pain. Wow, no Acolyte of Pain on turn 3. So he leaves that for turn 5, that would be my guess, to just instantly slam it.
Yeah, this does allow Ekop now just to develop the Imp Gang boss freely. Which would have been punished by the Acolyte of Pain a little bit, but again, it does seem like that's the line he's going to. Gnomish Inventor on turn 4, and then have the flexibility of Acolyte of Pain plus Slam on turn 5 as a default position, but he may find he needs to slam something offensively, such as Slam Execute on this Twilight Drake. We do know that he's playing the Iron Beak Owl, so he doesn't necessarily need to hold Executes for the late game taunts. He can just use them to deal with threats early on. It looks like that's what's going to happen here.
Mm-hmm. Does that execute? I guess he plays two, right? That's two double shield block two. Mm. That's quite interesting.
Yeah, so I think the unstable ghouls have been cut for sure from this deck, as well as the four drops that you normally see in the mid-range patron, either Shredders or Corcrons, some combination of three or four of those cards usually. Drake Corsairs as well we haven't seen, so these seem to be the cards that have been cut to make room for all these additional combo pieces. But as you said, this is a better opening here from Crane. He actually got his cycle early, and the cycle in Grim Patron Warrior sort of serves a double purpose of fighting for the board at the same time. So it's definitely what you want to pick up early on in the game. Whereas before, he just kind of drew all his combo pieces immediately and was just sat on them, you know, without anything to do for several turns. Just allowed the Warlock to get way too far ahead on the board.
That's true. That is a Bogan. I mean, Worgen, sorry.
So he's just going to shield block again. It looks like a good board for an Acolyte of Pain now. I wonder if he's going
to
use this Fiery War Axe. Seems
to
like it's
second DMing boss, I think.
Yeah,
so.
Seems like a pretty good attack, especially since you have the second Fiery War Axe ready to go. It makes a lot of sense.
And but you make it impossible, at least from the board state, to deal a packet of 2 damage to the Acolyte of Pain.
Yep. Also plays around Defender of Argus, which would have been just a clean one shot into the Acolyte without drawing the additional cards. So
very
makes a lot of sense.
Yeah. And I'm sure that Ecop doesn't want to use the Hellfire to kill that. No, that's just jokes.
Hey, if you're really desperate that your opponent isn't allowed to draw any cards. Yeah, Hellfire, pretty much the best card in this matchup.
Okay, now that's nice. You want to get double draw and discount all the combo pieces. Nope! Unfortunately, oh, and it would have been the perfect one damage.
Would have been, yeah. So that was the reason he attacked the Boombot. He wanted to draw multiple cards this turn to set up the Emperor. Is this enough to Emperor? You only hit the Worgen and the Charge in terms of relevant cards, so that's going to be 4 mana. Then a Rampage is going to be an additional 2, which is 6.
I don't think so.
That's I don't think it's enough, because you're not going to have enough mana left over for the Faceless Manipulator, so...
You need either Rampage already in hand too.
Yeah. Or the Faceless already in hand too.
Yes.
Yeah.
Wow, he plays it anyway.
Interesting. So he might be deciding that he doesn't actually need the full Faceless combo and that he can get the job done with one.
So just by catching him by surprise.
Right.
By catching him, I mean Ecop.
Yeah, with just like Worgen, Inner Rage, Charge, Rampage, or something like that. You know, he definitely has enough mana to do that. He's just going to play the Thorasun out as a 5/5 body here just to be a little bit competitive on the board. But a little bit surprising to me for sure, because he had that Battle Rage in hand, so he had the potential to possibly draw some additional cards very quickly over the next couple of turns, especially with the Deathbite Whirlwind coming up. So he definitely had the opportunity to have a slower Emperor that discounted more cards later in the game, but... That Dr. Boom being played probably just rushed him into making a more aggressive play, knowing that he doesn't have as many turns to finish the game as he feels like he might have done.
Now, it's also quite interesting to see. This is the pair that will be playing against Zedalot in the first semifinals.
Yes.
So whoever wins this matchup will play against a priest.
Right, and we saw an insane series of Zedalot versus it was actually just Handlock, right, that he played against Stan Sifka.
Yeah, it was Handlock, and it got smoked down with Flash Heals.
Yeah, so Priest versus Control Warlock is definitely a bad matchup. We saw a great exhibition of that in the first place from Zedalot, so I'd be looking forward to seeing another Priest versus Control Warlock matchup later on. But again, just seeing how this deck in particular interacts with Control Priest would be really interesting to me as well from Crane.
Another Acolyte of Pain.
So he's just going to play it out here, see if he can maybe try and encourage Ecop to send that 7 damage Dr. Boom into it, but
doesn't
seem like a likely scenario, right?
Well... Wait, is charged +2 or +3?
I think it's +3. No, it's +2.
Okay, that quite changes a lot because I was counting +3.
Ah, okay. Interesting. So that's
was it +3 in the first version when before Nerv?
I'm not sure. I think it's always been +2.
Okay, never mind then.
Anyway, back to the game. Defender of Argus is a nice pickup here. He can use it to buff up some of these 1/1s out of range of the Deathbite, but he is going to still have to solve that Acolyte problem here if he doesn't want it to draw additional cards. But he might be past the point of caring here. He might just be trying to be as aggressive as possible, get the Argus down, load up the damage, probably play a Dark Peddler as well, although if he was going to do that, I suspect he would have done it first. And so maybe the Peddler isn't going to be played here.
Okay. We didn't see a single brawl yet as Rampage. How much damage is that? How much damage is that? Worgen, he will be activated, will have Rampage. So that's charge 2. That should be enough, if I'm not mistaken. Because that's 5, that's 8, 16.
Six, 9.
And you kill both minions and...
Yep, yep, it's enough. He has double charge, so it's going to be enough to push through.
Yep, and that's about it.
Wow, out of nowhere. RKO out of nowhere from Crane, just takes the game. Looks and so far behind, and the top deck there just let him seal the game so comfortably with the Raging Worgen damage. 22 damage goes through the face.
And you know what? Eco lost this game because he taunted up the 1-1s instead of Dr. Boom.
Yep. I mean, it's hard to blame him for that play, though, because the Argus did create, you know, the Deathbite Whirlwind was in
created
play.
A different strategy.
Yeah, the Deathbite Whirlwind created a strategy, etc. Yeah, there was, you know, his board was full of 1-1s. You can understand him wanting to Argus those 1-1s to protect it from the Deathbite swing. But as you said, not taunting up the big minion after already having seen one execute allowed Crane to push through there. 22 damage to face with the Raging Worgen without even the full combo. There was no Inner Rage used there. There was no Faceless used there. So gives you an indication of just how much damage this deck is packing.
It's actually very interesting to see how much damage like possibilities you have. Because you can get, as you said, with the Faceless Manipulator, I think you can even challenge Control Warriors at some point.
Sure.
If you manage to pressure hurt them with some early game minions and just stack up the damage so he'll be around 40 HP, then you have still the chance to win the game with insane burst from double Faceless with double Worgen and some insane draws, right? With the Inner Rages especially.
Yep, yeah, it makes a lot of sense. What's interesting to me here is that Ecop is choosing to go back to the Control Warlock, the Reno Lock here, after seeing the amount of explosive bursts that Crane's deck is possible of. There may have been a debate to switching to Zoo. I mean, you can definitely switch to Zoo and maybe have a chance of picking up one win here, because this is probably a deck that's, you know, less equipped to deal with aggression than the regular Patron deck is. But even if you did switch to Zoo and you picked up that one win, Crane just switches back to the regular mid-range Patron, which has such a good matchup against Zoo, and you probably just lose that game immediately again from there. So it's a matter of, you know, how much you value it and whether you even feel like the Zoo has a better matchup. So I don't fault Ecop at all for sticking with this Control Warlock, but there probably was a little bit of consideration into whether the more aggressive deck would have been able to rush this deck down before it gathers the combo pieces.
Might be a problem. Might be a problem because your minions are not as effective as in usual decks that we see that are running two ops instead of, you know, different type of minions that have different... different roles in the deck, but are sharing the same cost. So now, that's the Kazan Mystic that won the game against Colento yesterday. But it will not matter that much today.
Okay.
At least not in this match. In this match.
Mind Control Tech is a useful card to have. But again, this is the kind of draw from Crane that he probably wants to avoid. He's just picking up combo pieces too early, that Taskmaster, the Raging Worgen, the Charge, etc. Not really what you want to have. You want to have the kind of draw that we saw in the last game where you get your cycle cards early as well as a Deathbite. So it looks like a Twilight Drake is going to get coined out here, and there's just no immediate answer to that in the hand from Crane. He's going to have to find some creative way of dealing with it over several turns.
Well, there's Silence.
Oh, you're right. Wow. I'm totally not used to having...
No one has a Silence, right, in a Patron Warrior Worgen deck.
I was just looking at his hand, like, okay, well, he doesn't have Deathspite, he doesn't have Execute, so this Drake is a nightmare to deal with, but yeah, you're right. Crane has the flexibility here of the Ironbeak Owl, and we brought it up the other way around previously. Like, he can use the Execute early because he can silence a taunt late. I guess he can do it, just he can use a Silence here for the same reason. Like, he still has the Executes in his deck to deal with the late game taunts. So, Owl Fiery War Axe seems like a pretty reasonable play here to me.
And the only issue is that I'm guessing Crane is not running any Brawls. Because he has double Owls, he has double Charge. I'm guessing he plays double Rampage. Might be a little bit too much, right? But it seems like there's no way he squeezed a Brawl here, so the Owl has a certain role in the deck, which is remove the taunt from the way.
Yep, absolutely. But as I mentioned, there is still those couple of executes that can do that job for him. Reno is now drawn, but again, this is not really a matchup where Reno is relevant. We overestimated the damage in the first place because of the counting the wrong amount of damage for charge, but mm-hmm. if he assembles a big enough Exodia in his hand, then he's still able to do 30 damage pretty comfortably, right? So.
Okay. Well, now this is not a comfortable opening hand for an open and draws for Crane. He has no cycle. He has no way of getting those important, crucial parts of his combo in his deck already. There's no Emperor either. There's no Rampage. He only has the Charge and the Worgen.
Yeah, very true. He is going to get to cycle a little bit here, though. A lot of damage to face, but he's already built up a lot of armor. And that is a pretty nice Emperor. There's a Whirlwind, there's an Execute, Cruel Taskmaster, Worgen, and Charge all getting discounted alongside the already zero mana Inner Rage. So that is a lot of damage. He'll be able to play a Worgen combo and Whirlwind Execute any taunts that are in the way.
Yeah, now it's very similar to the strategy that was... that was present in the first version of Patron Warriors, right? Because you discounted the executes to clear out the taunts from the way, and you charge with the wooded Rodent Berserker. It's basically very similar, but required less parts than this combo here.
Oh, and that draw is huge. I think we're going to see a windmill slammed Emperor Thorasan here. Crane is definitely calculating his turns here. How much mana everything's going to cost, but yeah, this is an Emperor turn for sure.
Well, you have 2 mana Worgen, 2 mana Charge, 1 mana Taskmaster, that's 5, and 6 mana. So if you get to draw another Rampage, you can play everything.
Yep.
And you can clear also a Taunt from the way.
Yep. Same thing if he draws 2nd Taskmaster, he's able to play that as well, so...
He needs... If there will be a Belcher in the way, then what Crane needs is a weapon. Wait, is that lethal if he plays the Emperor?
I have no idea.
Wait. I lost track. Let's count. Yeah. It's plus 4 damage from the Taskmaster in a rage.
Yep.
And plus 3 from Rampage. So that's 10, 11, 22. No, it's plus charge. That's 28, right? 26.
26. Yeah, this is exact lethal if we've counted it correctly. I'm with you. Right, cannot believe it, but yeah. Crane obviously has a lot of experience with this deck because he didn't, either he spent the time counting on his previous turn or he just knows exactly how much damage this costs.
I'm sure he just knows how much exactly damage it is. And wow.
6 damage, exact lethal on turn 8 with 6 mana. 26 damage for 6 mana. It's crazy.
This is why I like this format. We have so much new decks. So many new decks, right?
Yeah. Who needs Wasson Commander, right?
You have Charge.
You just put Charge in your deck. It's fine.
I'm really happy that Charge was nerfed the way it is right now. Imagine if that would be the old way of seeing the Charge, right? And we still have the Alexstrasza charging your face. With the gore hole on board? Yeah, that was kind of ridiculous.
Yeah, that deck was pretty awesome, though. It was fun. Like, it was stupid, but it was fun nonetheless. And yeah, like, after dropping the first game, Crane is validating his choice here to bring this deck to the tournament. Definitely, you know, it's a really interesting line because he's leveraging his experience with Patron Warrior. You know, he knows how good a Patron Warrior player he is, and he feels comfortable that he can beat just about anything with Patron. So instead of bringing a Control Warrior or any other kind of wacky aggro face warrior, whatever, he's just built another version of Patron that can rely on his same core skill set, but he's added in that Worgen tweak just to help him farm the control decks a lot more effectively.
Yep, exactly. And it's 4th time the charm, I would say.
Yeah.
Ecob really wants to win with his Reno Jackson Warlock, but I'm with you. I think he should switch the zoo.
It has to be worth a try, right?
Yeah.
I feel like you won the first game. You probably feel pretty good about that. But your opponent was sat there playing nothing for like 6 turns in a row. So, you know, I think you can put that down to a bad draw. And the 2 games where he's, you know, drawn what seems to be reasonably, you've got blown out really, really easily. Even in the third game when you had the information of what was coming, you still got blown out. So,
yeah.
You probably have to react to that situation and say, okay, this probably isn't a very good matchup. I need to make a change here.
Yeah, I mean, it's very similar to the old style matchups we saw. So the first iteration of Worgen versus Handlock, where that was the metagame. That was like a really biased matchup for the Worgen Warrior. It was like, I would say 75-25, maybe even more. It was really like, you could have play around big minions because there was so much removal, and you just went for the combo at some point of the game. Unless you didn't draw any big game hunters, executes, and brawls for the two mountain giants that were played 10-4-5. But, you know.
Yeah, I believe it was Nyria for a while that was bringing Raging Worgen Warrior to tournaments. I remember there's a really famous set where he like 3-0'd Kalento with Raging Worgen Warrior or something. I know you can find the VOD of that on YouTube somewhere. So definitely has a storied tournament history, but it's not really been a core part of the meta really at any point in Hearthstone's history. It's just been one of those kind of meta-reactive decks. And interestingly enough, that's exactly what Crane is using it for here, just reacting to a very very distilled, closed meta, expecting that he needs something to deal with the heavy control deck since the mid-range patron won't be able to see him through. And yeah, the Raging Worgen is looking to be a very, very good choice from him.
Mm-hmm. That's actually a cool deck to watch and cast.
Yes.
It's something that we are not used to, so counting the damage is not as fast as Crane is doing for us, at least.
Yeah.
But it's really interesting to see that kind of deck in the tournament.
Yeah. I remember when I first started, you know, playing the regular Grim Patron Warrior, which I ended up playing thousands and thousands of games in the mm-hmm, end. Like initially the maths is very, very complicated to do. Like, but if you were to give me a Warsong Frothing Berserker board now, I could tell you how much damage it is and straight away. But Raging Worgen is a whole different animal, not something that I'm used to counting. So I've just been sat back letting you do the maths on this one, Lothar.
But I love the As much I think that the first version of Patron Warrior was very oppressive for the game, I loved the deck because it was so excellent to play. It was so high skilled. But the problem is, because of the potential power of the deck, it was just too much to handle, right? Yeah. For the game itself. So unfortunately, the cool game design, because of the strategy overall, not the sheer power, it was nerfed to the ground. But quite unfortunate that it couldn't be balanced out to still have that type of the deck in the game, but it wouldn't be so powerful at the same time.
Yeah, makes a lot of sense. Ecop here just going to play out the Dark Peddler. Not too much to do early on, and that's not really a great choice. Power Overwhelming, I guess, will go nicely with the Shadow Flame in his hand if he needs an emergency clear for some Grim Patrons. It looks like he's just taking the tournament attendee just to have some tournament, because I guess it was the highest value minion available. So
the problem is the tournament attendee dies to Wyrwind.
Yes.
It's practically useless. It takes a space on the board.
Pretty much, yeah. So we're just going to axe down this 2-2 here. But again, this is a little bit of an awkward draw here from Crane. Not the kind of draw he's looking for. He wants to hit that cycle early, and he's just picked up a couple of patrons, which are nice. Obviously, that's kind of your mid-game distraction tactic in this strategy more than anything. Just try and get some patrons down and force your opponent to waste a turn or two to deal with them while you draw more combo pieces. But he doesn't really have the activators for the patrons either, so kind of suffering a little bit here.
Mm-hmm. Well, Sylvanas on the board. There was still no Emperor this time, so Ecop is in a comfortable place still, right? Because he doesn't have to be worried about, well, I guess I'm dead next turn. So now he has to be as aggressive as possible. By the way, the Draxus is a great, great, great card again in this matchup. Then you can kill it with a Worgen with two cards and not five.
Yep, so Fiery Warrox is going to come down with the Execute, and it looks like he is just going to go for the Patron board here, just get the two patrons out with the Inner Rage. It's going to require an answer for the 3-3 patron. No, wow! He doesn't have an Inner Rage, just a patron on the board. 3-3 patron.
It requires an answer from Ecop.
It does.
That's actually a cool thing to do, because you can't really ignore the patron, so you have to play something that kills it immediately. To kill it immediately requires a Siphon Soul, Twisting Nether, Shadow Flame. Sorry, not even Shadow Flame, because you would have to invest in a minion that has 3 attack. So Hellfire, And eventually, it's a Defender of Argus, which is the MVP card in this matchup, so you can't really spare that card. So right. What do you do here? Siphon sold that?
It looked like he was considering maybe a Loetherb Sun Fury play by just taunting the Loetherb and you going at it that way. But that's so risky, right?
You can't do that. I'm sure Asylum can't do that. Because if you do that, then your opponent can still develop a Slam or a Inner Rage and get multiple patrons out of this. Because you attack first, and then you multiple them. Whoa, Siphon Soul on your own minion? That makes no sense.
It looks like he is going to go for the play here, and honestly, like, I can understand this to an extent, because the minion you're taunting is Loetherb, and you have the Loetherb effect as well, you kind of remove quite a few potential punishes from Crane's range. Like, you know, Inner Rage can be used, but it's going to be pretty much the whole turn, and Execute, same thing, like, how is he going to get an activator for Execute and the Execute done? So yeah, it's a risky play, but he may have just looked at his hand, and the only alternative really was the Siphon Soul. And he thought, felt like there's just no way he could just pass the turn essentially back to Crane by spending his whole turn on Siphon Soul. Mm-hmm. He's gone for the risky play here. And as I said, the range of punishes is quite limited. Crane does have the option for the Inner Rage, but that is a valuable combo piece being used if he does go down that line.
Yeah, that's true. Like this time, Crane doesn't have a way of cycling through the deck. So he's running low on cards. He can threaten Ekop enough.
All right, so Demon Wrath is drawn. Only really one proactive minion in the hand for the Reno Lock, which is kind of an issue that they do have. They do play an awful lot of reactive cards and sort of only one copy of each of the good minions. So they can sometimes just run out of stuff to do a little bit. But he has Sludge Belcher to play out here if he'd like to, but he may even choose to pass that up because of how clean it is against the Deathspite. Gonna tap, try and look for a better option. It's another reactive card here, but that Hellfire is great to have when you're staring at that second charge of Deathspite, because you may be expecting a second patron to come out here, especially after the first one was used so loosely, right?
Yeah, but it was used so loosely in the first game, but yeah, that was a second patron in the game. In the hand. So yeah, Eco might have that in mind by gathering the experience from the game one of this matchup. This is something that we don't have in Hearthstone at all. You can't gather the informations from the matchup if you win it, right? Mm-hmm. Sorry, if you lose it, an example.
Yeah.
Because the deck goes away in Conquest.
Right.
But this is a learning curve, right? Because you have this matchup so many times, you can make a mistake in a game one or two or gather informations from your opponent's deck and learn something or develop a strategy to counter your opponent.
Yeah, very true. I think the ideal draw here for Crane would have been a Battle Rage, so he can at least cycle out these cards from his deck. Been able to make the patron play, but while drawing cards with the Battle Rage to get more of those Raging Worgen combo pieces. But it looks like he's going to hold back the Inner Rage as a potential Worgen activator here instead of making the full board of patrons. Staring over at his opponent's hand, he has so many cards in hand, he's probably suspicious of a Shadow Flame or a Hellfire, which can both do some work here, so... chooses to hold back the Inner Rage. He's going to keep that for the burst damage with the Worgen that we've already seen a couple of times. But he's just low on cards here. Hasn't hit the cycle. No Gnomish, no Acolyte, no Battle Rage. So he's kind of a long way short of his eventual goal here.
Mm-hmm. Is there a Twist and Nether in the hand?
I don't think so. There is a Hellfire, a Demon Wrath, and a Shadow Flame. But
and the one legendary class is card is like...
Yeah,
overshadowed, right?
One card hidden behind the Siphon Soul, but I don't think it's Twisting Nether. Just
it like... has to be legendary card because of the dragon, but...
Ah, okay. Oh yeah, I think it's Fugan or Stalag.
Oh yeah. Right.
Yeah, Stalag.
By the way, it doesn't work with Feigned Death, you know?
Wait, really? Like, even on the second one? Like, you still don't get the fight?
I still remember the time when I was playing with Noxious. A show match, and I used like I dropped Fugan and Stalag on board, and instantly played Feigned Death. None of them were dead, so. Yeah.
Oh, right, good point.
It was a hilarious moment, though.
Yeah,
we had quite the laugh. So this looks awful. What are the options? No options for Crane.
No options for Crane, but kind of very few options for Ecop either. So I love this play. Just like, all right, I'm so far ahead right now. He only has four cards in his hand, but we've seen what four or five cards can do in terms of burst damage. So the Reno Jackson back to 30 definitely seems like the safest option here. Threatening lethal quite comfortably the next turn. So Crane is going to have to make something magical happen here. But
if he would draw the charge, he would be able to play the whole hand. So that will be 5, 8, 10, still 20 damage on me.
I think he would have to have drawn Battle Rage and then gone for the Worgen play, Battle Raged into more cards, and then one of those cards would have had to have been charge and the other one would have had to have been more damage. Even then, like, I don't think that would have been enough, but yeah, long way off being able to make any plays here. And he's just going to have to concede this game out, and this series is going 2-2.
Yep, that's true. And it's the two games that we saw that Crane lost were because his deck is a combo piece deck, right? Yeah. I mean, sorry, two games that he lost. He didn't lose this time yet.
Well,
but I'm guessing he will concede in the next 90 seconds. But the only games that he lost right now are because his deck is combo piece orientated, so he can whiff on draws. If he whiffs on draws, then the problem is you have useless cards that are just sitting there awkwardly and waiting for the perfect moment, which will never come. And in this situation, even a cycle for the draw, it will require basically a cycle to cycle to cycle. And this, the perfect scenario for next turn will be shield block, into slam, into battle rage?
I
don't know.
Whoa!
Gyraxus finishes up the game! I said it's the useless card in this matchup, but look at that, it's a weapon.
Yeah, when it kills your opponent, it turns out it's quite useful. But yeah, I'm pretty sure that is the only situation we'll be seeing Gyraxus used in this matchup, because 15 Agreed. Health seems pretty risky in this scenario. But Ecop ties it up, goes two games to two, and I guess is being rewarded for his decision to stick with the control warlock a little bit, but as
is
you
he
mentioned
being rewarded? Yeah, I think just Crane was punished by his deck choice, because he just, from my perspective, Crane is losing because of his own deck, not because Ecop is playing oppressively.
Yeah, agreed. Ecop really hasn't managed to take down a game where Crane has got a reasonable draw so far. He's only won the games where Crane is just sat with combo pieces in hand and just no plays to make onto the board. But looking at the opening hands here, we see that Acolyte of Pain and Gnomish, those were two of the key cards that let him get himself going in the first game that he won, I believe. So I'm sure those two cards are considering being kept. Inner Rage might even be kept to help cycle along with the Acolyte of Pain. But I'm sure he'll be digging for weapons alongside this as well.
Well, excuse me for a second, I need to reply. Okay, so this time it's a reasonable draw. You have three cycle cards. Wow, we're looking at Wage Shield Block?
Yeah, I think
that's
he's just,
interesting.
I think he's just looking for weapons, right? And picks up the Death Spite here, which is just that card that you just... I don't care what warrior you're playing. You want to have a Death Spite in your
opening
hand.
Yeah, it will be a problem in the standard format.
Yeah, really.
You are losing the best weapon in the game.
Yep.
By the way, it's kind of peculiar. When Death Spite was being shown in the preview of Naxxramas, everyone was like, Arcanine Reaper is better.
Really? Who said that?
I was arguing with people like, you have Arcane Reaper, which is basically better because this weapon can't, like, it won't be able to deal with the 5 HP minions unless you attack twice. That was reasoning that I heard the most and read on Reddit and read on, like, card previews from articles that were being published back then.
Okay.
So remember writing some opinions on Naxxramas cards for Gosso gamers. I need to Google that.
I remember having the argument with people, you know, I said Deathspite was going to be one of the best weapons in the game, and I remember having the argument that, like, people, no, True Silver is probably still going to be better, and, like, that's the argument I remember having, like, Deathspite versus True Silver, but I find it crazy that anyone would think Arcanine Reaper was a better weapon, I don't know.
Yeah, people are just negatively... how do I say that? They just have negative thoughts about the weapon in general, that no one would use it, because there's no real need to have a whirlwind on a stick, but it's actually the biggest advantage of the gun.
Yeah. Anyway, I mean, no one could have predicted the whole Grim Patron thing coming out afterwards, but even like when Despite was released, right, like, you know, playing an Acolyte and just whirlwinding was a play that Control Warriors made just to cycle cards. Mm-hmm. So, I don't know, it seemed obvious to me that that card would be really useful. But anyway, going back to the game, the first Acolyte was owled to prevent some of the cycle, but fortunately for Crane, he had the second Acolyte as a follow-up. And now the Battle Rage is going to allow a lot of cycle over the coming turns here. Loads up that Deathbite to get the Whirlwind effect. And if he can get that Gnomish Inventor down on the board next turn, play the Battle Rage on a following turn, he's going to be in a pretty good position to have cycled through a large amount of his deck.
True. And he needs the Emperor, as I said. But it's still not looking not looking bad even without the Emperor, because he has so much survival cards, right? There's the shield block, he has the weapon, he can kill the Zombie Chow. The Zombie Chow will heal him to 29, which is the perfect number for sure. 29. Yep. And he can still use Battle Rage for the cycle. So that's awesome. I would probably wait with the Gnomish Inventor turn 6 alongside with the weapon, so you can cycle with the Battle Rage. Oh my god.
Emperor, please! Alright, Lurtheb's pretty good. It'll lock out the Battle Rage this turn, but he may just decide to go down the Sludge Belcher line to try and protect his Stalag on the board. Wow.
What? A tap? I'm baffled now. There's no way in hell that you can do that. You have to be super oppressive against this deck. If you're not putting power on board...
He's just given up the board and given his opponent potentially like a free patron turn, a free Battle Rage turn. I guess like saying free patron turn, maybe he's looking at his hand and going, oh crap, I don't have any answer to patrons right now, and he's sat holding onto a Deathbite. So maybe the fact that the Deathbite wasn't used on the previous turn, he's expecting to see Patron Whirlwind come out this turn. Oh my god.
Okay. Do you do it this turn? You have double Battle Rage. I think you do it.
Yeah, it looks like he's going for it. He has Faceless, Worgen, Taskmaster, and Charge in his hand already. That is a ton of discounts.
Oh my god, and Ekop makes a grin right now, seeing the Emperor. He knows what's coming.
He does, yeah, and he has no answer to this right now either. This is going to be a double tick Emperor unless he taps into something.
And this is why it was so important to put anything on board.
Right.
Because then you can... Even if it's a patron, you still have something on board that can kill at least one of them, and you can count on maybe some removal from your deck, because you will have guaranteed removal on your board. So it's way better to count on double draw, right, instead. And in this situation, you are sitting against an Emperor with a combo deck. That's you can't really do that. You don't allow that to a druid.
Yeah.
And in this case, it's even worse.
I mean, I'm sure anyone who's played this game for more than a few months, who has played against the old school Warsong Grim Patron deck, knows this feeling, right? I cannot kill Emperor. Oh, crap, I've lost the game. Like, there's just no way you ever beat Patron Warrior after a second tick of Emperor Thorazan. It just doesn't happen. It's not a thing.
Well, how much damage is that next turn? A lot.
Yeah. Roughly 362 damage.
So you just played the weapon this turn. And you can also faceless your Emperor for double ticks this turn. But no, that's a bad idea. But it's just a cool thing to do, right?
Oh, the greed. I don't need damage. I just want my combo to be cheaper. I want to be able to kill him for like 2 mana.
I guess you just go for the one cycle. One Battle Rage weapon deal... 8 damage to the face?
Sure.
Maybe, no, you can do that. Because even if you deal 8 damage to the face, your opponent is at 16. So, no, you actually can't. Because you can't put 2 taunt minions on board right now.
Oh, that's a very good point, actually. Right.
There's only 1 taunt minion, so you don't deal the maximum damage. You might just deal the 3 or the 5. And that's about it. If you cycle.
So I guess he doesn't hit, right? I guess, if he's hitting, he spent a long time thinking while we were joking around about Faceless Emperor and stuff, so I guess he's calculated that he does still kill through Molten Giant Sun Fury here.
He has zero mana Battle Rages right now, but was it better to have zero mana Battle Rage instead of having
one extra
the next
cover.
Draw that was discounted? Let's see what will be the next pick from the deck, right? Mm-hmm. And would it matter? I'm sure that Crane is much better than we, than both of us.
I'm pretty confident about that.
With this deck, but I'm just interested in the options that you have in this deck, right? By the way, the whole hand costs now does cost 6 mana.
Oh, Emperor! What a glorious card! Like, there's an element of sarcasm to that, but like, I'm really pleased that Emperor was added to the game because it just created so, like, just created so many new strategies, right? Just added so many like new cool combo decks to the game, and it just like allows you to do all these new and interesting things that didn't work before. So like, it's a really fun card to be in the game, just in terms of like being able to see this kind of nonsense happen.
Okay, so this is GG. That's more than lethal. That's 800 damage, and the shield block wouldn't matter this time. So probably was better to have the double Battle Rages in hand, so you can get how many cards right now? 6 cards for 0 mana.
Yeah. I just have the Benny Hill music playing in my head right now.
Oh, wow, look at that. That's 3 attacks with 8 damage.
Alright, and Crane takes it down. 3-2 with this creative Raging Worgen Grim Patron Warrior.
Awesome to see. We had 5 games of this Worgen deck. Awesome to see, and we'll see it against Zetalot Priest, because I'm sure that Crane will pick this Worgen deck against Zetalot, right? It has so much potential against Priest, because the problem is Priest has only Deathlords. We talked about this during the Druid game, right? There's only one taunt.
But an interesting point is, if he gets the Deathlords early, what happens if it pulls out, for example, Faceless Manipulator or Raging Worgen, except there aren't that many minions in the deck that can
that's
be pulled
true.
Out. So the Deathlord can just rip apart the whole strategy of the deck.
Well, that's cool. That will be an interesting semifinal. But for now, sorry for Ekop, he lost. Happens. But Crane advances to the semifinal against Zetalot. And the next match that we'll have in a few minutes will be between Life Coach and AKA Wanderer, so G2 versus SK Gaming, and that's about it. We are jumping to a short break. Don't go anywhere. This is G2 Class Legends Invitational. Quite an interesting tournament. Don't go anywhere. We'll be right back.